Welcome back. And in this session, we will now look at another important aspect of business decision making, which is dealing with financial decisions and communication, how to communicate with various stakeholders so that the correct business decisions can be taken. On the financial tools front, we will look at a couple of tools that are widely used in making business decisions, and the important questions that these financial tools help address are which projects to pursue or how to value a company. And a very important method, there are many methods, but we will look at a few very common and important and easy to understand at a high level. We will look at methodology called discounted cash flow analysis, DCF analysis, which is a valuation method to determine a company's or a stock or a project or an asset, anything. What is its intrinsic value? And that analysis is done based on all the future projected cash flows. And cash flows can be both positive and negative. Positive cash flows, as in the money coming in, the investments that are made in the company, for example. And outflows are the expenses, the salaries, the taxes that have to be paid. Anything that goes out is the outflow. Anything that comes in is the inflow. And considering all of these cash flows, both positive and negative, of the future years, 3 years down the line, 5 years, up to 5 years down the line, or even longer, it helps you arrive at the value of that company or a project today. So take into account all the future expected cash flows and figure out or calculate what is the value of that asset or company or project today. That's what the discounted cash flow analysis helps to do. And with that, a decision can be taken whether to pursue a project or invest in the company or not, if you see profits based on this analysis. And we will see that in the next few slides. An important consideration in this methodology is the time value of money. We all know that a pound in future does not have the same value as it has today. In fact, it has less value. Obviously, if you think about it this way, if someone borrows, let's say, 100 pounds from you today and says that after 1 year they will return 100 pounds to you, will you lend that $100, 100 pounds? No, you won't, because you would have actually made some money by investing that 100 pounds in even as simple as in a bank account and earning some interest on that. So your 100 pounds today would have increased to some other value. Depending on the interest rate, it would have increased to some other value in future. So if 100 pounds in future are not the same, your 100 pounds today would actually be more than that in future. The reverse of that is 100 pounds in future is worth much less today. So that's what is the time value of money, and that is at the core of discounted cash flow analysis. Let's understand this a little bit more. So let's say on today, right now, you have 100 pounds. That's what is called a present value, or PV. 1 year from now, the value will be 105 pounds if the interest rate is 5%. So 5%, so on 100 pounds, you earn 5 pounds. 105 pounds is your future value. That's called FV. So it's as simple as that. FV in mathematical terms can be written as the future value is equal to the present value multiplied by 1 plus R, where R is the interest rate, 5% in this case, 5% is 0.05. So 100 times 0.05 is 5. So 100 plus 5 becomes 105. So in a mathematical terms, it's written like this. The reverse of that is, if I have a future value, the future value or the present value is equal to the future value divided by 1 plus R. So if I have some future cash flow values, what is their current value? What is their present value? If I have to do that, just like here I am multiplying with 1 plus R, I will have to divide the future value. It's the same equation written in the opposite way, so that you can calculate the present values from future values. Here you are calculating a future value from a present value. So that's what this simple equation is. If there is no other investment, you have one present value and you are looking at a future value 1 year down the line. Now let's complicate this a little bit more. So again, we have a present value today of 100 pounds. And 1 year later, if the interest rate is 5%, it's 105. Now, complicating it a bit more, second year, what happens? Now the interest is going to be earned on this 105, not 100. So 105 times 1 plus R. Just like this one was 100 times 1 plus R, this is another 1 plus R multiplied to this value. And then if we keep on going, in the third year, interest on top of this. And then in the fourth year, interest on top of this. And we can go on like that. And that is now the future value after 4 years of this 100 pounds. I have not invested anything more. I've just let this 100 pounds earn interest over a period of 4 years. This is what you might have already learned earlier as compound interest, not simple interest, but this is now getting compounded. And for that formula is, the future value is equal to present value times 1 plus R times 1 plus R times 1 plus R times 1 plus R. So 1 plus R 4 times. That is what? 4 years. Once, twice, three times, four times. So that gives us 121.55. And if we go the other way, calculating the present value from a future value, present value is equal to future value divided by 1 plus R to the power of 4. And this is because we invested for 4 years. And if it is n number of years, it would be future value divided by 1 plus R to the power of n. So here, when we are calculating the future value, we call this an interest rate. But when we are calculating the present value from a future value, we are discounting this future value to arrive at the present value. And that R now is also called a discount rate. So we are discounting a future value to arrive at the true present value using this formula. Now let's complicate it a little bit more. So in the previous example, what we had done was, we invested 100 pounds today and then let it go for 4 years. Now let's say we invest another 100 pounds at the end of the first year. And that goes like this. It's also earning the same interest. After the first year, it earns 5%. It becomes 105. Then after the second year, it earns another 5 and it comes to this value. And then another value, it is this value. Let's say at the end of second year, I have invested another 100 pounds. It earns interest for 1 and 2 years, only 2 years. And likewise, if I invest 100 pounds at the end of the third year from today, this one earns interest only for 1 year. So this investment earned interest for 4 years, this investment earned interest for 3 years, this investment for 2 years, this investment for 1 year. And now the future value is like that. The 100 pounds here, and for 4 years it earned interest. This is the second present value at the end of first year when I invested this. This earned interest for 3 years, and like that you go on, and the total future value is 452.56 pounds. I invested 100 here, 100 after the first year, 100 after the second year, 100 after the third year. So total 400 pounds I invested. My future value is 452.56. So that was what discounted cash flow, that's how it works. So let's take an example. If you invest 100 pounds today, and now I'm changing it slightly from the previous example, I'm not doing same 100 pounds every year, but 100 pounds today, 200 pounds at the beginning of year 2 or end of year 1, whatever way we want to look at it, 300 pounds at the end of second year. What will be the future value at the beginning of the fourth year or the end of the third year? So I invested 100 here, 200 here, 300 here, and I want to see my future value here. The interest rate is 10% instead of 5%. So the same formula that we used here, again the same thing, just these numbers have changed. This was 100, this is 200, this is 300, there is nothing here. So 100 times 1 plus, and the interest rate now is 10%, so it is 0.10 and to the power of 3, because we are looking at the end of third year, so 3 years it earns interest. 200 pounds earns interest for 2 years, 300 pounds earns interest for 1 year, and my future value is 705.1 pounds when I have invested total of 300, 500, 600 pounds. Now let's look at the calculation of present value from a future value. So this is the reality. This is how you will be valuing a company or valuing a project. This is how you will be doing the calculations. So suppose a company is expecting a cash flow of 100 million pounds at the end of the first year, another 200 million pounds at the end of the second year, and another 300 million pounds at the end of the third year. What is its present value if the discount rate is 10%? So now you see how this analysis is now becoming very powerful. You don't know these values, you are only expecting these in future. Based on that, today you want to know what is the value of this company if this is how the revenues or cash flows are expected. So the same calculation we did earlier, the present value is the first value, 100 million, that came at the end of the first year. So I have only lost, the interest rate for 1 year. So future, this 100 million divided by it was there only for 1 year. Then 200 million at the end of 2 years. So again, 200 million divided by 1 plus 0.1 to the power squared, and 300 million at the end of the third year. So that comes under this formula, which equates to 481.59 pounds. So you see, while the company is expecting a revenue of 100 million at the end of first year, 200 second year, and 300 at the end of third year, a total of 600 million, those 600 million pounds in today's money are only 481.59 pounds. This is the true value of this company today. So now you have to make a decision. If a company is expecting the cash flows, as we just saw, what is the net present value? We have not discussed this. We have been discussing the discounted cash flow analysis method. Two of the important and commonly used techniques in this method are net present value, and we will see the second one in a few slides from now. The net present value, if you want to invest $450 million in this company today, the company is expecting $100 million at the end of first year, $200 million at the second, $300 million at the end of third year. So with those cash flow expectations, you want to invest $450 million in this company today. Is that a good decision or not? Now, the net present value is calculated as the present value of all the future cash flows. These are the calculations we just saw in the past few slides, minus the initial investment. So the present value of those cash flows we calculated in the last slide is £481.59 million. If you are investing £450 million today, this is the present value of those, and this is what you are investing. 31.59 million is the net present value. Now, since this is a positive thing, so whatever you are investing, the present value of those future cash flows is higher than this thing. Your net present value is positive. It is a good decision. You are making a profit and you should invest in this company. Now, if I said no, I did not want the investment that I am expecting is not 450 millions but 500 millions. If that is what the investment is required, now the net present value is 481.59 million minus the investment of 500, which is minus 18.41 million pounds. So, in today's money, if I invest 500 million, in today's money, the future cash flows are going to, although my total is going to be 600 million pounds, in today's money, that will only be equal to 481 million pounds. So I'm actually making a loss. Instead, I could just invest this 500 million in something else where I am getting this 10% interest rate, and I will be making more than this amount 3 years from now, or more than that. So this is how this decision based on the discounted cash flow methodology using the net present value, you can now make a decision. The other important method, we just saw net present value. The other important method is called the internal rate of return. Now, we have been looking at this interest rate or discount rate of 5%, 10%, whatever. So, the rate of return that makes the net present value equal to zero is called the internal rate of return. What does that mean? That the net present value is zero, which means the difference between my future cash flows in today's value, present value, minus my investment is zero. Which means my investment is going to be equal, exactly equal to the future cash flows in today's value. So that means this is the interest rate which is going to exactly cause break even, no profit, no loss. Now in the previous example, instead of 10% interest rate, if I had used 13.25%, I did some calculations, and I will show you in Excel in the next few minutes how to do that. But at 13.25%, my present value of those 600 million pounds would have been 450.78 million. And if my initial investment required was 450 million, it's about the same as this amount, 450.78. Net present value is this minus the initial investment, which is almost zero. So 13.25% is the internal rate of return, and this is what is another way of making those decisions in the discounted cash flow methodology. And in Excel, let me just now show you the Excel. This is just a screenshot. So here is the same example, and I have typed minus 450 because I am paying money. I am not getting money. So this is a negative number. So if this is the investment I am making today, after the first year, my cash flows that are getting generated are 100 million. After the second year, 200. After the third year, 300. And if my discount rate is 10%, then the way to calculate my net present value is equal to NPV. There is this function available in Excel, equal to NPV. And the first thing it requires as input is the rate, and I have typed the rate here, so I will just select this cell and then the data, all the values that I am going to be getting in future. So I will just select all those three values and close the brackets, parentheses, and hit enter, and that's my value. However, note that this is not really the net present value, even though I use that function. That is because I have to subtract the investment that I am making today from this value. If this investment were made not today, but at the end of the first year, if this had been made at the end of first year, then this value would have given my net present value. That would have become my net present value if this investment had been made at the end of first year. But if this was made at the beginning, then I do not include this in this function. But what I do for now calculating the net present value is to add what we had been learning in the slides previously. This is the present value, subtract the investment, and that gives you the net present value. Since we have taken a negative number here instead of subtracting, I am just adding these two up. It means the same thing. And so essentially, from these are the numbers we saw in the slides also. So the present value of these future cash flows minus the initial investment, that gives me the net present value, 31.59. The function, and let's just see, I showed that 13.25 was the internal rate of revenue. Let me just change this 10% to 13.25, and you see the net present value, or the present value, was 450.78, and net present value comes down to this almost zero, and that is my internal rate of revenue. You don't really have to calculate that, because in Excel you also get the function called IRR. Returns the internal rate of return for a series of cash flows. And in this case, you include all of these numbers, and that is what gives 13%. So this is as simple as this. You calculate equal to NPV, where the first thing you have to give is the rate of return and then the future cash flows. And in the internal rate of revenue, you just select all of those data points and you get your value. This is what we saw in the Excel file. And now there is again an activity. Calculate the net present value and internal rate of revenue for two projects. I have given for these two projects, I have given the data, and in both of them, investment you need to make today is 450 million pounds. If you notice, if you add all these future cash flows up, you will see that both of them, in both the cases, you are earning 825 million pounds. The sum of all of these is 825. sum of all these is 825. But the way you are earning them is different between these two. So I would like you to do this activity, assuming I am not mentioned here, but assuming the discount rate of 10%, which project would you undertake? So you will have to now calculate the net present value for this project, net present value for this project, calculate internal rate of revenue for this project, internal rate of revenue for this project, and based on that, tell me which project you would undertake. And normally, if the net present value of one project is higher than the other, then you would undertake that project. So I would like you to do this exercise. You can do this calculation manually, just like I have shown in the examples in the slides, or you can use Excel to get those values and do these calculations to make that decision. So you have now learnt a very, very important analysis methodology, discounted cash flow, a very commonly used method where we saw two ways of doing that, the net present value and internal rate of return, and you can now make financial decisions while trying to plan on where to invest, what project to take up. So with that, we completed the financial tools aspect also, and the final part in decision making is, and very important, is communicating properly. And communication is both verbal and written. Verbal communication is through presentations, and written communication is through the technical reports that you will be writing, that the management is going to be looking at. And these two, along with examples, we covered on October 2nd in Unit 8. So I would like you to go and take a look back at those presentations, and you will be able to know what are the various sections that should be included in a report. You have done a lot of that in proposal writing also, but in the final report, you will also have the benefit of having done data analysis, and you will be reaching some conclusions which normally are not there in the proposal because you are only proposing what you will be doing. Here you have now all the information available to write a report and make recommendations to the business decision maker on what decisions they should take by looking at the data analysis. And in this whole process, when you were learning how to work with data in the big data, you learned about a lot of tools that will help you make good business decisions. We saw R for using data analysis, but at the same time, we saw Excel in parts. Then you use Microsoft PowerPoint or Microsoft Word to make presentations and write reports. And we looked also at Microsoft Project to do project planning. We also looked at Open Project to do project planning. So you have actually now looked at a variety of tools to be able to use at in different aspects of business decision making. Thank you, and I would like you to post any questions that you may have in Piazza, and we will respond to that at the earliest. Thank you and good luck.